Hey, Forever Family, welcome to Celebrate Recovery Crisis Response. I'm a grateful believer in Jesus Christ. I struggle with codependency, anger, and anxiety, and my name is Frankie. Welcome. We are so glad that you are with us tonight. We are just going to jump right in. So without further, here's Casey.
Hey, CR family, I'm a firm believer in Jesus Christ, a firm believer in our Lord Jesus Christ. I struggle with anxiety, low self-esteem, and my name is Casey. I hope you guys are having a great week so far, and I'm excited to get to be with you guys again this week. Let's worship. Listen, greater is the one. Greater is the one who's in us. Greater is the one who calls our name. He will never fail. Stronger is the one within us. Stronger is the one who fights for us.
Ah.
Welcome back to the Post Family Dining Room. I'm really excited about tonight's service. Mandy is going to share her testimony with us, and it's a timely message for us. May is Mental Health Awareness Month, and so Mandy was originally scheduled to share her testimony this weekend, and as we talked, we thought, well, should she do it, should she not, what do things look like? And so I'm very proud of her for being willing to continue to share. You'll see what I mean by that here in just a little bit. Hey, if you are new to this program tonight, welcome. We are so glad that you are here. Celebrate Recovery is for anyone with a hurt, a habit, or a hang-up. And if we're honest, that's every single one of us. So we're glad that you're here. This right here will be an opportunity for you to chat. There's a chat going on right now, so feel free to jump in on that, be a part of that, and just know that at the end of the night, all of that goes away, and then we will later post this video to Facebook. All right? Love you guys, and now here's Mandy's story.
Cool. Well, it's good to see you.
It's good to see you too, Frankie.
Glad you're here. Thanks for doing this.
Yeah.
So let's just get started off like this. Tell us about that t-shirt. I see the word hope.
Yes. This shirt is from the Out of the Darkness Walk. They have it every fall, I think around September. And it's the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. There you go. And so I've, you know, raised money for that. I feel very strongly about that. It's something that I strive to get more awareness for in our community. And I have always felt very strongly about, but now even more so.
Okay. Since the virus, how has this affected you personally during this time?
for me and even those kind of around me, a big thing is it's just constantly being a struggle of being surrounded by uncertainty. It's always something that I've struggled with, the unknown. I don't do very well with that. You know, there's a big concern because I work at a hospital, and an even bigger concern because the patients that I work with are 55 and older. So that's one of the biggest risk categories.
Okay.
So for me personally, it's it makes me nervous, and I worry about going out into public spaces or another's home. Or even just being with different people, because each time I am, I feel like that increases the chance that I might carry something to my patients and expose them. So I've just been trying to be really careful with my interactions and trying to social distance as much as possible. My husband and I are both furloughed 50% of the time, so we're both working reduced hours. Okay. My schedule's been different every week. I work different days and shorter hours, but our patient load is about the same. So that's been an interesting challenge. So it's just, I have to really pay attention to what day of the week it is, what the schedule is for that day, so I can be prepared appropriately. So just kind of all over the place right now, but trying to make things work the best we can.
Gotcha. Okay. All right, let me back it up a little bit. So what brought you to Celebrate Recovery?
So I wrote out this story so I wouldn't be long-winded, because those of you that know me, I'm a big talker and I'll ramble forever. so I kind of wrote this part out, and I hope it makes sense. I'd heard about CR through church services at Community Bible for at least 2 years before I gave it much thought. I instantly labeled it as a program like AA or NA, so I didn't think that the program was for me at all. However, I knew that I felt absolutely miserable, burnout, exhausted, and anxious all the time. It was like I was treading water, barely keeping my head up while trying to breathe as I was gulping down water. That's the best way I can explain it. 2012 was really a pivotal year for me. I had just gone through 6 months of basic fertility treatments because my husband and I had not been able to get pregnant for 3 years. We made a decision to buy my grandparents' house and land. And within a month of making that decision, we sold our first house and moved here. The house hadn't been lived in 4 years and was in a lot worse shape than we expected. And the layout wasn't functional either. So we had to make the hard choice to pull or to put all of our money and our time into the house and put all the fertility treatments on hold. My dad also started pushing away from me at that time. And he had already done that with the rest of the family. So I can honestly say that that is when his mental illness took a turn for the worst. So I felt abandoned by him and emotionally hurt. All while I was working a job in mental health with adolescents who were hurting, depressed, angry, suicidal, etc. On a daily basis, I was trying to help them, comfort them, and encourage them while trying to keep myself calm and not take anything that they said or did personally. I didn't do too well with that last part. My perfectionism was at an all-time high, and no matter how hard I tried or how much time I put into something, I always felt like it wasn't enough. But when I was praised for doing good, I felt guilty because I knew that I could have done better. And I was also anxious because I felt like I then set the bar ridiculously higher each time, and that I would have to do even more to get the same amount of praise in the future. I also lost my ability to use a lot of my coping skills at that time. I had always been really creative and loved to craft, to play music, to dance, spend time with friends, go to movies, or just veg on the couch and watch TV. But every free moment was spent remodeling our then gutted house at that time. And I became very resentful. That there was no downtime for me, and that is something I don't do well without. But then I felt guilty because if I said I didn't want to work on the house, because my husband always did. And so there was just that constant struggle. One Sunday that summer, I was getting ready for church at the time in our makeshift bedroom, bathroom mess, and Celebrate Recovery popped into my mind. I had no idea where it came from, and I hadn't heard about it at church in months. I thought it was a weird thought, so I brushed it off. It just so happened that part of the sermon at Fort Smith campus that day was about CR. I was a little taken aback, but I brushed it off as a weird coincidence. I was good at doing that. The following Sunday, I decided I wanted to try out Community Bible Van Buren since it was closer to my new home. I always sat with a coworker at Fort Smith, so I knew if I went to Van Buren, I would be by myself. It was scary, but I convinced myself to go and that I wouldn't be alone because Jesus would be with me. That's what I told myself going in, that I could do this because Jesus is with me. When I found a place to sit, a small movie clip started to play about Celebrate Recovery. It was very simple, and it listed a series of different hurts, habits, and hangups, such as alcoholism and drugs, but it also included things that I was shocked to see. I saw the word perfectionism, and it was like I took a punch straight to the gut. I saw the quote, everyone thinks I have it all together. And that was really how I felt at that moment, because I'd always tried to smile and put on a brave face, but I was miserable. So that one really resonated with me. As I sat there bawling my eyes out in an unfamiliar place with nobody that I knew, I finally felt like God was trying to reach out to me and tell me to go. I discussed it with my husband that night, still having no idea why I needed to go, but explained that I had an overwhelming feeling that I was supposed to. I even thought, well, maybe God wants me to go so that I can help somebody else. Codependency, right? Yeah. I faced obstacles that attempted to lure me away from going, such as not having much support from family after several calls, having no friends that were available to go with me. At one point, I finally looked up and said, okay, God, I get it. You want me to do this by myself. And I was very frustrated with it, but I did. Because of where I worked, I saw people that had been through horrific traumas that seemed to make mine look so minor. So I felt like I didn't deserve to be upset or depressed. I was worried that people at CR would scoff at me and that tell me that I didn't need to be there or that my problems were stupid. That's with my heart just absolutely pounding out of my chest. I had feelings of pins and needles, like I was going to puke. I walked through the doors by myself and I saw something completely different. People smiled. They greeted me. Without pity. They invited me to sit with them. I felt like the kid on the first day of school. But they invited me in. They talked to me like I was already a friend. I cried so much that night, listening to the worship music and listening to Ed speak. But no one looked at me like I was weird or judged me. I've always been very self-conscious of being so emotional, and I kept apologizing to others, but they just kept telling me that it was okay. I never hit a specific rock bottom, and I never really experienced a huge aha moment either, but slowly I started to see a shift in the way I viewed things, most likely because I started to view things from God's point of view and not my sinful own. I started making friends with people who were real and not superficial. People I could tell my deepest, darkest feelings to, and they wouldn't push me away. People who didn't try to shut me up when I cried, or that would walk away from me because they didn't want to hear or engage in something that was so emotional at that time. I met some of the healthiest friends through CR, and they've been a big part of my overall change. They support me no matter what, and our friendship is unconditional. That's the big word there. It's unconditional.
Yeah.
With their love and support in the midst of learning and applying the 12 steps and the 8 principles, I have finally been able to find my peace. I looked back at some of my participant guides from 2012, and 3 of the biggest things I wanted to change was, number 1, my worry and my anxiety. Number 2, the relationship with my dad. And number 3, worrying about my pregnancy. Now that it is 2020 and I've been in recovery for almost 8 years, those problems haven't changed. They're all still there. But I've changed my ability to cope with them. I spent so many years wishing and praying for all of my problems to go away, when in fact, this world is a fallen, broken world where nothing is perfect. But we're made to lean into God and to trust Him, His plan, His timing, and the hope of everlasting life. We were made to be in constant communication with Him about everything, not just the big things, but the small things too. Every moment, being in constant communication with Him. And He'll never turn you away.
That's right.
I can't say that I've perfected that, because lots of things tug at me for my attention. But in my weakest moments, and when I'm starting to feel the pressure of the world like I used to, I remember to pray and to ask Him for help. I also reach out to my accountability team, my open share group, and my sponsor for prayers and support. Not for answers or how to fix my problem, just allowing others to support me briefly until I can get back on my feet again. Then I'm able to do the same for someone else. And so a new cycle continues. I thought long and hard that I wanted to break the cycle of codependency, anger, resentment, and playing the victim role, such as is in my family history. But it's nice to know that that cycle can end with me. Not solely me, but with the power of God within me and the support from all of my CR family. To help keep me focused, to keep me accountable, and to keep me from falling back into my old patterns. That's why I started CR.
Good stuff. Awesome. Let me ask you this. How are you doing today? How do you cope with this virus?
So one of my biggest coping skills is reaching out to my open share group when I'm struggling. They can offer prayer without having to ask me 10,000 questions like, you know, your family wants to know. They won't judge me for feeling my emotions. So that's been a big help. One of my biggest energy releases, especially because, you know, if you're stuck at home, it's good. One of the biggest ways to relieve anxiety is exercise. So I can't say that I always do exercise, but I do get out of the house and I move. With gardening, I've been doing a lot of that lately, mainly working in my flower beds. And then I've been trying to do, I'm trying to get a vegetable garden started. I did a small one last year. I'm going to expand and do a bigger one this year. So I have a little greenhouse, and I've been, I planted a bunch of stuff from seeds, and I have all these pretty little plants right now, and I'm so excited to plant them. But it makes me feel really good to be able to like take care of something and to see something grow just because of the time and effort that I've put into it. So that's a big one. And then for relaxation, I like to listen to music. I'll play my guitar. I'll do puzzles on my iPad. There's a jigsaw app that's really awesome, and it's super easy to use and free. And then I do coloring. I love adult. I don't believe this right now, but I'm trying to. So if I can summon it by, you know, doing positive things, positive words, maybe it'll eventually come to fruition with me. So, just trying not to put any expectations on when things are going to go back to what they say is going to be the new normal, and just focus on one day at a time.
Good. Okay. Awesome. You recently had a family tragedy. Walk us through as much or as little of that as you're comfortable with, and kind of how you're dealing with it all at this time.
So since I'm working limited hours, on April 22nd, I was home that day planning to attend a conference for CEUs online, when my husband called and said we needed to go to my dad's house. I had not been there, obviously, like I said, in several years, and haven't heard from him, so I knew that that was not a good thing to get. That call. It's been 8 years since I've spoken to him on the phone, about 6.5 years since I've gotten maybe a text message back. He had been very depressed, and he became so anxious around social situations that he had stopped all contact with everyone in the family, and then it trickled down to eventually even me. I'm his only child, and he's not married. When he dropped contact with me, I knew that things were kind of taking a turn for the worse. I have grieved this abandonment for many years, and it's been one of the biggest struggles I've worked through while I've been in recovery. I had to accept the fact that I could not fix him and I could not force him to get help, no matter how much I knew that he needed it. When I got to his house, there were several police there, local police, the sheriff's department. And they came to talk to me and basically told me that my dad had committed suicide. Sadly, this wasn't a huge shock to me because of how sick he had been for so long. But he refused to get help. He thought that going to therapy was just complaining about your problems and somebody pitying you. He had tried medications for a while, and honestly, that was one of the best moments I had with my dad, was about the time that I got married, and he was doing so good. But for some reason, he stopped. He didn't think that he needed it, so he stopped taking it. I had to deal with talking to the sheriff, hearing small details. They were very professional and tried really hard to not traumatize me, I guess. Mm-hmm. I had to speak with the coroner and answer questions about things. They said that, we heard that he lost his job, and I told him it was in 2012. He hasn't worked since then. They're like, well, I heard that he was divorced from your mom. And I said, yes, since 1994. So, I mean, these were not new triggers. Right. They were trying to make sense of it. It's just been compounding for a long time. After everything was done, they did not make me identify him. And I'm very thankful for that, because I don't want.
Sure. Yeah.
I didn't want that to be my last memory. And then they left after that, and so it was me and my husband there standing at a house with a storm coming in, and then it's, what do you do next? And so, I mean, it was literally having to go into that house and seeing how things were left. There was no note. There was no final goodbye. It was just silence. We had to secure the house and fix the door that they had to bust in, we told them that was okay. They had to. And then we were responsible for making sure that any valuables were out of the house, because burglaries apparently are, it's a higher risk after somebody passes away. I didn't know that, but so they kind of warned us about that. So it was just kind of a mad scramble to try to make sense of things while trying to get the house to where it would be okay when we weren't there. And there's, I couldn't find any paperwork, any will, anything. So now all of the decisions were, they're on me. So we went from that to meeting with the funeral home the next day, having to write an obituary. And then I also have to now meet with a lawyer because as far as I know, I can find nothing that's in my name. And I don't know if that was purposeful or if that was just that he had no motivation to do things. But even though I'm the only heir of everything, I still have to go through the whole legal process in order to be able to access anything. So there's a lot of anger and a lot of frustration that's going on with this as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. So this is, May is Mental Health Awareness. What would you say to someone who has been down the same road as you now? And what would you say to someone who's maybe, who struggles with mental health?
I guess being in my position right now, all I can say is thank goodness for CR. Because if I didn't have that foundation under my belt, I would be an absolute mess right now. And I know that I would not be coping very well. But I know no matter how I feel, that I have people that are going to be there for me and support me and pray for me. And I've had a tremendous outpouring of help and support during this time, which has been very good. So a big part is knowing that I'm not alone. You know, there was a few people that I knew through CR that have experienced somebody close to them committing suicide. It's not a subject that people like to talk about.
Sure.
But it's real and it does happen. So I'm kind of done with hiding it. And now it hits a lot more closer to home than even before. As somebody that struggles with those thoughts, again, you're not alone and you're not isolated in that. And I truly believe that mental illness is no different than any physical illness. If I have a predisposition to heart disease because it runs in my family, I'm probably going to get established with a heart doctor and monitor those things and take heart medicine to make it function right. If I have diabetes and my body doesn't produce its own insulin, I'm probably going to follow up with a physician and have insulin that I can take or try to eat healthier and change my diet so I can do things to help my body recover. If I have a mental health issue, there's no difference. It's just a different organ in your body. But because it's your brain, people think, oh, it's all in your mind. Or you can just snap out of it. Or, well, you don't have it that bad. Just think positive. Those things are not helpful to anybody. Because when you really struggle with that and people tell you that, then you feel like, well, crap, nobody understands. And so I just better not say it to anybody. And then you feel isolated again. And that's one of the worst things that you can feel. So it's not true. It's worth getting help. You're worth getting help for. You're worth it. And you deserve to feel better again. It took me, even though I started CR and I knew that I had some anxiety issues, it still took me a while to admit that and to get help. I started seeing a therapist after my first year. We started talking about family history, and there is a very prevalent history of anxiety in my family, along with depression and alcoholism, amongst some other things. And she basically looked at me and was like, so if all of these people have anxiety, why wouldn't you have anxiety? And it was kind of one of those, like, I needed that slap in the face to go, I probably do. I just want to think that I've made it this far. I've coped this long without medicine. Why do I need it now? But it's not like one of those things that gets better with time. It's just like any other organ in your body. Eventually it starts to kind of break down and that problem exacerbates and it gets worse. So I finally got enough courage to establish myself with a doctor, and I went in to, you know, tell her some of my issues. But that day I was feeling really good, and I was like, you know, I don't think I need to tell her about my anxiety. I don't think that's really an issue. And so I went in and I started telling her, you know, she started asking basic things about what was going on. I told her about all of my infertility stuff. And of course, as soon as I say the word infertility, I start bawling. And then about the house remodel that we were still completely in depth, because that was a 2-year process. And then I'm just my job in general, because it was just very stressful. And she finally stopped me and said, Mandy, so what's the main thing that we need to focus on? And I had to say the words out loud. I said, my anxiety. And I'm like bawling my eyes out, thinking, oh my gosh, she's going to think I'm so dramatic, or that I'm just coming in to seek medicine. Or I was so worried about being judged by a doctor. And I was humiliated and mortified because I had to say that out loud. And when she came in and said, okay, you know, she left, she came back and she's like, okay, we're going to start you on this medicine. And I was still just like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I don't think I can do this. And then I started taking it and I'm like, hey, this feels good. Like, I don't have to live in this hypervigilant state all the time. And it didn't zone me out. It didn't make me into a person that I really wasn't. I was, you know, worried that it was going to change me. No, it just brought that anxiety level down enough to where I was thinking rationally and I could function. And then it was just like, I was kicking myself thinking, why didn't I do this years ago? I mean, this really, I've lived this long feeling so miserable when all I had to do was accept the fact that I had a problem, that I needed help, and to ask for it. And then to follow the directions from the doctor. And so it's just breaking out of that mindset of you can do this on your own and that nothing's wrong with your brain. You know, it's clinically proven that you have receptors that are not recepting things like they're supposed to, or you're producing too much of one thing that's overwhelming your brain. Or if you've been through big traumatic events in your life, you know, it can change the way your brain functions to no fault of your own.
Sure.
Yeah. So it's really just about accepting help, getting it, especially when you hear from several people that, hey, maybe you should try this. You know, don't push it off. Don't believe that it's not going to help. or fear that it's not going to work. And it, one thing I can definitely say when it comes to medications, especially mental health ones, is that nobody's the same. So it's going to be a little bit of a trial and error process. Just like that's you see point. That there's probably commercials for 12 different types of cholesterol medicine. You know, you're going to have to try a couple to find out what works best for you and gives you the least amount of side effects. It's the same thing for mental health. You've got to kind of work through some of those different trials of medicines to figure out what works best for you. Because unfortunately, there's not a specific blood test that you can take and the doctor goes, oh, well, you have this and this, so I'm going to give you this magic cocktail to make it all work. It doesn't work that way. It's a process. It's a long process. But the longer you do it, each step that you take one day at a time, eventually things start to improve little bits. You don't see it in the moment, but then you look back over a certain amount of time and you're like, holy cow, like I'm doing a lot better.
Yeah.
You know, I looked back at my CR book from 2012. Those problems aren't any different. They're still there. And in fact, obviously the relationship with my dad is left hanging, you know, it's what do I do now? But I've learned better tools to cope with it through medication. I started seeing a therapist again a year and a half ago, and that has continued. And I've been honest about what has happened. So now we're meeting more frequently. and that's okay. You have to take charge of your own health, and you have to be able to voice what it is that you need in that time. And there's times when I'm so overwhelmed, I don't know. When I met with my therapist for the first time after this traumatic event, you know, he said, okay, when should we talk next? And I told him, I was like, I have no idea. I don't know what's when, where I'm going to be, what time. My mind is just so all over the place. And he told me, he said, well, when you experience something as traumatic as this, it's probably a good thing to talk sooner than later. And so I was like, okay, that's all I needed to know. So I scheduled it for 2 days later. And then I had another good session this morning.
Okay.
So right now there's telehealth. So I don't even have to go to the office. I can do it online in the privacy of my own home. And it's very safe and confidential.
Awesome. So that was one of the things I was going to ask you too is, you know, James 5:16 says, confess to one another so that you may be healed. And there's healing just in talking, and which is what you've just mentioned. You've also expressed how you are experiencing healing. Can you flesh that out a little bit more for us? And maybe for someone who's in the midst of this season of coronavirus, right? And social distancing, what that looks like. How would you recommend people to do just that?
Knowing the steps that you need to take and actually doing them are two totally different things. And I see a lot of people that struggle that are really good about telling others helpful things or places to get help or things to do, but not carry it out themselves. Just do it. That's the best thing I can say when it comes to healing. Yes, it's going to hurt when you have to bring some of this stuff up in therapy. You know, you can't just wish it away. But I can say, okay, so something a friend told me, a friend of mine that she is a therapist. She talked to me about, it's kind of like an old wound, right? Mm-hmm. And if you've got this nasty, deep wound inside, you know, the longer you try to cover it up on the outside, it may look okay, but it doesn't mean that it's not still rotting away on the inside. And so just like if you have a bad wound and you have to go to the hospital, sometimes they have to dig out or vacuum out all the nasty rotten stuff in order to get to the healthy part so it can start to heal. And so in the middle of that, you're going to be in pain temporarily and more pain than when you just cover it up. But that's when the healing process can actually begin. So you have to kind of work through some of those deep hurts, get it out, make sure that you've got a good support system at that same time. You know, don't be at it alone, but make sure you've got good support. Make sure that you're taking care of yourself, that you're trying to get the appropriate amount of sleep, that you're not using a lot of substances to keep you awake or to bring you down. You know, eat healthy. I know you hear all these things a lot of time, but you really got to do a lot of self-care and be honest with your therapist too, you know, during that time about, okay, this is too much for me. Maybe we need to kind of back off, or I don't feel like we're getting anywhere. We might need to bump it up a bit. Like, you can say that to them and they'll work with you. They don't have to lead you through each little thing. You know, you don't have to, they shouldn't have to pull it out of you. We'll put it that way. So, I mean, there's that part of it. Sorry, awesome. I lost my thought on that one.
No, you're fine.
I had more. Yeah, that's it. That's all I got on that
one. That's all right. That's good. Well, that's all the questions that I really had. I know this is, we talked the other day, I guess I don't remember if it was phone or text, but, you know, and you just originally, I think you texted me and said, hey, I was supposed to do my testimony. I'm not up to doing that right now. And I was like, I get it. And then here we are with this. And I know that there's healing, even for you, you know, and this type of a process. And so I can't thank you enough for being willing to do this and to share this with our people. And you're a superhero. Proud of you. I'm going to continue to pray for you and keep doing what you're doing. You're an inspiration to a whole lot of people. Some that will that don't know you yet, but will after this is shown. So can I pray for you?
Yeah, definitely.
All right. Let me pray for you. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for Mandy. I thank you for her willingness just to share her story and what all's going on with her and just these recent days and past couple of weeks up to the past few years. And so, God, we just thank you so much for her heart, her willingness to share, especially at a time like this. God, just give her the strength that she continues to need. Just guide her, direct her. Thank you for her team, her support team, her therapist, her sponsor, her accountability partners, and her friends that are just continuing to love her through this time. God, we love you and we praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. Awesome. Thank you, Mandy.
Thank you, Frankie. I'm glad that you let me share.
Yeah,
this means a lot to me. One of the biggest things I've learned from CR is that I don't have to hide anymore. I don't have to hide behind secrets, and that it's okay to be vulnerable. I was always taught that crying and being emotional is a weakness. But through CR, I've started to learn that it's actually a strength. And it can work just as well as any other kind of behavior that other people will put off as confidence. Yeah. This unfortunately is my confidence. It is the crying and the emotional side of me. I kind of wear my heart on my sleeve, but that's who I am, and I'm not afraid to show it.
Awesome. Thank you. So good. I appreciate it.